You see, all our people know in the churches now is they've had their sins forgiven. And they've been submitting to inward sin for years. I don't believe there's a man on the whole TV that preaches salvation. They preach forgiveness. Forgiveness is not salvation. They point out, there's a man in bed with some other man's wife in the motel. He says, you know the Lord loves you just as you are. Well then why get changed? Commit adultery as long as you like. He still loves you. Be a cheat, be a liar, be a thief, be a failure. He still loves you. But there's a scripture, isn't it, the Psalm 7? Don't look, I think it is. But it says, God is angry with the wicked every day. I heard somebody quote today, God loves you but hates your sin. That's bunkum. God hates you for committing the sin. Is God going to take your sins and judge them at the judgment and leave you alone? Well, some say there's no trouble for us at the judgment, but it says that man who has failed God, he shall suffer loss. Not his sins, he shall suffer loss. You know, 5 minutes inside of heaven, we'll all be embarrassed. We wish to God we'd been more faithful. We wish to God we'd been more obedient. Are you saved from lust? Are you saved from fear? Are you saved from doubt? Are you saved from anger? Are you saved from envy? Are you saved from pride? He came to save us now from sinning. Christianity is NOT, not a sinning religion. It's a victorious religion. The great curse in modern preaching is this, our people never see God. I don't believe 1% of the Christians in America or the world know God. They know theology, they know about God, they know references in the scripture. But who really knows God? I've said before, I'll say it many times, I guess. I think every preacher should read Acts 26 on his knees every week, where Paul outlines what the preacher is there for, to turn people from darkness to light, the power of Satan to God, they may have forgiveness of sins, and an inheritance amongst them that are sanctified by faith that is in me. And then when you've digested that, go to the 40th chapter of Isaiah and get the concept of God that this amazing man has. You'll never get depressed. Now some people have worn the page out, the corner of the page, Romans 8:28, that's all they know. I don't think God enjoys the sun and the moon and the stars. They can't respond. He enjoys the man that's been digging ditches down the road all day, but he had a heart in tune with God all the time and he was praying. You know, the salvation of America does not rest on the White House. I don't care who gets it. Well, they won't care, I do. The salvation of America does not depend on the White House, it depends on God's house. And before God does anything, he'll clean up the church. When he was on earth, he cleaned up the temple. If he comes again, he'll clean up the pulpit. Judgment must begin at the house of God. Judgment must begin with the preachers. I think the most awesome task in the world tonight is not to be the President of the United States or the King of an Empire, but to be a man who stands between a living God and a dying people. I'd like to send a notice to all the deacons of every church in America. If your preacher doesn't weep over the congregation, weep over your preacher. I would not be a member of a church that doesn't have a prayer meeting Saturday night. Saturday night from 9 o'clock till midnight. Or Friday night, 9 o'clock till midnight. You do it, it will revolutionize your church. I say to America what I say to you, God doesn't owe you a single thing. The reason you're a dwarf spiritually is we won't eat the word of God, you won't wait on him, you won't hear his voice, and you won't obey him. The secret of revival is obedience. You can't obey what you don't know.